I have no idea how this video is going to go, but I do know that the clarifications that I'm experiencing are tremendous. Now, what will occur to say, I don't know. But these videos, of course, are for the repentant, those who have repented. Okay, they're not for the unrepentant. They're not for the unrepentant because the unrepentant will inherently confound what is being said. Inherently. Because they're on the path of grandiosity still. Keep in mind that this dream of existence is grandiosity, 100%. The belief in incompleteness is grandiosity. That is grandiosity. It's the path of grandiosity. It's the way. And so they will, of course, they will confound the gospel, the good news. The good news is that in all of creation, which is perfectly complete, there is not the slightest, tiniest, infinitesimal need for the slightest infinitesimal complete need to be completed. Okay, so in all of creation, there isn't the slightest, tiniest need for even the tiniest infinitesimal need to be completed. Not the tiniest need for any completeness to take place. Let me see if I can say this again. Get this through. In all of creation, and all that there is all inherently God creates perfect completeness. There is not any tiny aspect of existence that has even the tiniest need to be completed. Okay, let's put it that way. There's not even the tiniest bit of reality that has even the tiniest need to be completed. Absolutely none. And this is the entire gospel right there. The entire truth. This is the thoughts that we think with God. This is the thought we think with God. That's all we really need to know. So, the repentant can hear this and understand it. They say, yeah, that's true. I get that, but I have a continuity problem, of course. So the repentant means they understand, oh, I have a continuity problem. I've been trying to be greater than God. I've been on this grandiose path of thinking that I'm trying to complete something, that something needs to be completed. A path, evolution, progress, all this stuff. We're trying to, on a path of getting better and completion. This is grandiosity. So they realize, repent from grandiosity. And then they say, okay, now I can understand the teaching that there's not even the tiniest bit in all of God's creation, which is the only creation there is, that has even the tiniest need to be completed. To be completed, a need to be completed. Everything is created complete and perfect from the get-go. So any belief, even a tiny belief that there's some tiny need to be completed is nothing but grandiosity, meaning spirit wanting to be greater than God, all right? And from this, even the tiniest bit, they will not understand. It will confound truth and say, which truth says there is no need. And they'll say, no, they won't hear that. They'll hear you saying that there is some need. It's just very difficult or, you know, something. Or you saying that means you're terrible or you're disrespecting, you know, what we can do. You don't believing in, you know, they'll confound it. For sure. But as soon as you repent and say, no, I've had enough of this stupidity. I'm not going to try to be totally stupid, totally grandiose. That's enough. Let me repent. Then you become aware, one, of the truth, the thoughts that you think with God, and you say, oh, that's understandable. And two, you say, oh my gosh, I have a severe continuity problem though. Okay, but you don't confound it. You see, when you repent, you don't confound the teachings, the truth, the thoughts we think with God, which are the teachings we need to hear. You don't confound it anymore. You keep it clear in your mind, but you have a severe continuity problem. So you feel like, well, I just can't, I don't know if I can accept that. I don't know if, and how can I, you know. Okay, so the teachings are always for the repentant. So I will, for instance, just using myself as an example, I have not really had the breakthrough, final breakthroughs to claim I'm, make any claims yet, but at some point, we all will, at some point I will certainly be able to make, you know, really very clear, adamant help here, but I will say that in general, and I will just use this example for the sharing, I will defend these teachings to the repentant. And defending means I will insist on the clarity of them, and insist on repeating, and insist that there's a wow to them. And so you need to full stop in the wow. Don't analyze the progress or the profundity or anything. Don't worry about anything. Just it's a wow. I will defend that absolutely. But to the unrepentant, I won't defend anything. I won't defend any my teachings at all. Any of the thoughts I think with God. I will not defend that at all. It's a complete waste of time, and you'll just go around in circles, and it'll end up being confounded anyway. So this is the breakthrough I had this morning, asking for help from the Holy Spirit, from Jesus, from God. Jesus representing the sonship, which is all one. And this is what I got. I said, don't even bother to defend yourself, your teachings to the unrepentant. It's useless, totally useless, because they're still on the path of grandiosity, and that's what attracts them. And teachings say it's impossible. Grandiosity is just an absurd, whimsical, you know, whimsical caprice. And they'll say, no, the teachings have to support grandiosity. So they'll twist it. No matter what you do, they'll twist it. They'll argue, you know, they cannot accept it. Whereas the repentant right away will accept it. They just, you know, when I hear this, I say, yeah, I see that that's true. And the story, except continuity fear. And I was like, wow, you know, this is astonishingly great news. That everyone, all spirit, the oneness of spirit, without any exception, is inherently complete, absolutely perfect. Without the slightest need for any completion to take place, not one of us who find ourselves in this ridiculous dream of grandiosity with bodies and nature and stuff, there's not one of us that has the tiniest need for any completion to take place to their spirit. All of our spirits are perfect and complete. What is that? Absolute freedom. So being created is absolute freedom. That is, how is that incomplete? There's no incompleteness in absolute freedom. It's absurd to suggest otherwise, which we did, which is an absurdity. So, my mistake is, I tried to teach the unrepentant too. There's a mistake, and trying to hope there's some legacy that can be left as a mistake. There's no legacy. That you can have among the unrepentant, other than a distorted legacy. That's it. It's impossible to have a true legacy among the unrepentant. Totally impossible. So you should not even aim for that at all. You know, Jesus said he came to for the sheep. In other words, the repentant ones. And we're told that to these times the harvest will take place. What harvest of what? Ripe fruit of those who are repentant. Those who are repentant and do not confound the truth. They say, oh, I hear the truth. I can hear it. Yes, that's true. I agree with this. But I have a continuity fear. Yeah, I do. So the only reason I'm dragging my heels is because of this continuity fear, not because the teaching is somehow not clear. It's as clear as a bell, isn't it? In all of creation, all of the oneness, there isn't even the tiniest need for even the tiniest bit of completeness to happen. Okay, I am spirit, I am free. There isn't anything that needs to happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. There isn't anything that needs to happen to me. Okay, and this is true for all of creation. Crystal clear, isn't it? Crystal clear teaching. And the trouble is, is we don't factor in the continuity fear. So we think, hey, you know, I got it, and I should be able to tell everybody and even heal the unrepentant, and then you start tripping over yourself, and because you haven't yet let the wow sink in. And so because you haven't let the wow sink in, you can be easily manipulated by the unrepentant. And then you get defensive. And then you get confused. Because what is there to defend is crystal clear. There's nothing to defend there. There's no need for any defense. It's absolutely crystal clear. And then you feel a need to complete. You still feel a need to complete something because of the continuity fear. You didn't recognize it, and so the unrepentant will say, "Well, you still need to complete something." And then you'll start thinking, "Well, what do I need to complete?" And you get pulled down into confusion. So the path has to acknowledge this continuity problem, this continuity fear. That's central to it. Otherwise, you'll think there must be something additional. In other words, that this teaching needs to be added to it to complete it. And I said, I am spirit, I am free, there's absolutely nothing I need to complete me. So then how can you say, I need to add something to complete this? So if you don't recognize the continuity fear, you'll think you need to add, it's still something that needs to be completed. So this is the confusion we get. No, nothing needs to be completed. We simply have this continuity fear, like, wow, this is such great news, I'm shocked, let me get used to this. That's it. So the repentant are often quiet. They spend a lot of time just sitting quietly, not seeming to think very much, or, you know, don't need to do too much thinking. Maybe if they're sharing the truth, they might do some what I'm doing, sharing the truth here. But I also spend a lot of time just quiet, you know, and not trying to be complex or anything, just simple, simple-minded. Be very simple-minded. Because the truth is absolutely simple. I am spirit, I am free, there's absolutely nothing that needs to happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. There's absolutely nothing that needs to happen to complete me. There's absolutely nothing that needs to happen to complete me. I am spirit, I am free. I am spirit, I am complete, I am free. There's absolutely nothing that needs to happen to complete me. I am spirit, I am free. There's absolutely nothing that needs to happen to complete me. It's that simple. And this is true for all. All is spirit, all is free. There's absolutely nothing that needs to happen to complete anyone, anyone at all, to complete the allness. Absolute freedom is reality. And how could there be any need to complete that? There isn't. Nothing in particular needs to happen at all to complete absolute freedom. So the wow factor is already here with me. Just sharing this, it's how could it not be a bit, just a tremendous wow? Whenever we see the truth clearly, it's always going to be a wow until this continuity, you know, fear. Continuity, we get so used to it, you know, then it's just, we're used to the wow. Now, grandiosity has its arguments, very tricky, clever arguments, but it's accounting, the way it accounts for its position is outrageously bogus accounting. We will say this, but they claim, as if you drop this dream of grandiosity. You are dishonoring their adventurousness. Okay. But I would say that this is not so much adventurousness as it is grandiosity. Okay, which is a mockery. It's actually a mockery of adventurousness. It is what it really is. We're mocking ourselves. So how can you, what kind of accounting is it that you can say mocking ourselves is really the true intention of our freedom, to mock our freedom? You know, that's, so you can't say that dropping the mockery of our freedom is mocking our freedom. See, this is outrageously ridiculous accounting, and they have all these complex accounting things that they think they, you know, they tell you, and they, once you get into their accounting, that's when you get confused. So what you have to say is, no, say, listen, okay, we'll make a deal. We'll have to make a deal. Even though it's absolutely outrageous to claim that this is, that dropping this is somehow mocking freedom, that dropping the mockery of freedom is mocking freedom, totally outrageous, bogus claim. But we do acknowledge, to a tiny extent, that there is still a tinge of you know, using our freedom in this way. Still, you could say, just a little bit, you know, tiny bit, we can understand just that. But okay, so just the fact that we're here teaching here is enough honoring, and abiding in supernature is more than enough honoring of whatever adventurousness there is in mocking our adventurousness, in mocking our freedom. That's more than enough honoring. Okay, more than enough. And draw the line there. It has to be drawn, because if you don't draw the line, they will insist that you pay attention to their accounting, and their accounting, the way they account for this, is endlessly confusing and confounding, and level confusion and plausibility. They just have this massive, endless justification of why you don't dare. They call it you're trying to separate from us. You're trying to separate from grandiosity. You're trying to separate from the spirit. It's great endeavor here. It's great adventurousness here, and all this stuff. And claiming you're inferior. You're dishonoring spirit, and we'll never honor you anymore. You're a black sheep, and all this. They'll say all this kind of stuff. Now Jesus went even so far to honor this absurdity. He said, "Okay, all right. I'll show you." I'll show everyone, I'll honor it by even being crucified. I'll allow you to crucify me, okay? But having done that, we don't need to do that, because that's an absurd, it's absurd honoring, okay? But Jesus already did that. So Jesus honored the absurdity of this ridiculous accounting system that they have, that we, grandiosity, has. He said, okay. But once I've done that, that's it. Don't have to do it anymore. I've already done it. So we don't have to die. We don't have to be crucified, actually, if you accept that Jesus already honored this account. And of course, they rejected this. They said, no. But he did it. So that's an absurd thing to do. But he honored even the absurdity, the absolute outrageously bogus accounting schemes that we keep dreaming up of. You know, say, oh, you're trying to separate from spirit by no longer continuing to try to be grandiose and greater than God, and mocking freedom and mocking adventurousness. You know, it's ridiculous. So you're not honoring insanity. And so Jesus said, okay, I will do that for you if that's what you want. But once I do it, it's done. That's it. So you see, those who accept this, there's no need to die, actually, anymore, to honor this ridiculousness, this bogus claim that somehow, by not going along with this dream of trying to complete what we are, that somehow we're dishonoring spirit, dishonoring God, actually, they claim. You know, totally bogus. But we will accept supernature. We will accept. So we won't, you know, just drop the dream entirely. We'll give it a little more honor. Honoring our creativity in at least devising all this nonsense, you know, this nature. We'll honor it. We'll go ahead and honor that. That's fine. That's it. That we draw the line there. And again, the unrepentant will never accept this. Never accept it. They'll confound it. Of course. They'll throw it into their accounting system, and it just gets completely confounded. Whereas the repentant will say, okay, that sounds, I understand that. That's good. It sounds good to me. And that's it. Very simple. So there you have it. I was able to explain it. This is what I got this morning. I understood it this morning. And then we'll just, accept the wow of this for a little bit. So again, there's no legacy, there's no true legacy you can leave among the insane, those who are pursuing grandiosity. Grandiosity meaning, no, we need to complete what we are. We're incomplete. There's incompleteness. God created incompleteness. We have to complete it. It's our task to complete it. Grandiosity says, God's creation created incompleteness, and our mission, special mission, is to complete the incompleteness. This is grandiosity. God did not create incompleteness. The creation of reality is absolute, perfect, flawless freedom. And how could that be incomplete? How could anyone say there's some incompleteness there? But we said, well, God did not create us free to mock our freedom. Well, look, of course he did, because that's what we're doing here. So this very existence gives the lie to the very premise upon which existence is based. That God didn't create absolute freedom because we're not free to mock freedom, and here we are mocking freedom. It's ridiculous to claim that somehow there's some foundation upon which to continue to pursue this nonsense. The very fact that this nature exists, it proves that there's no reason for it to exist. It's self-canceling. It's a house of cards entirely. And the unrepentant have such a severe continuity problem. They realize it's a house of cards, and they say, oh my gosh, I got such a... What happens when it collapses? What happens when it collapses? Well, supernature, you don't have to collapse it all away to, completely. Honor it a little bit. You don't have to honor it a lot. You don't have to go overboard to grandiosity. Supernature, everything is complete. There's nothing incomplete there. So you can see nature in like a complete form, with no processes, changes, anything needs to be added or subtracted, everything. It's just to see, oh, this feels complete. Okay, great. You honor your creativity. That's all you need to do, is just honor your creativity, if you want to, but because your continuity fear, you will want to. And then once you feel satisfied you've honored your creativity, and then you have a little chuck laugh at how stupid it was, and then say, okay, it's enough, and then you don't even need supernature anymore. Don't even need the death-free realm, don't even need that. So, repentance comes when you have somehow you realize, hey, you know what? God is not angry with us. Our full power is still with us, and we're certainly capable of providing an intermediate step. God has actually provided an intermediate step for us, however you want to express it. It won't all collapse. We don't have to collapse at all. But for some reasons that there are those who remain unrepentant for a while, and again, they cannot be reached in the unrepentant state. There's no teaching that can really reach them at all. They will confound it for sure, to agree with their confusion, which is defense. So I think this is the toughest realization for me, is to say, no matter how great you teach here, you cannot have any legacy among the unrepentant. You cannot leave a legacy among the unrepentant. It's not possible. Not possible. Look at this world, hell bent on getting rid of Jesus. The unrepentant ones here, absolutely hell bent on it. As far as they're concerned, the world that they want is a world where Jesus never existed. That's their goal. You know, like John Lennon said to all the unrepentant ones, imagine, no heaven, just imagine that you don't have any of this religion or teachings of Jesus or any of this stuff. imagined it never happened. This is what they're after. So zero legacy. It was zero legacy. And if we think we're supposed to protect the legacy of Jesus in this world, this is a problem for us. You see? Now, I did meet with Jesus recently, several months ago. And I was gauging his attitude and everything. And one of the things I was gauging is he upset about what's happening in this world where he's losing his legacy here, essentially? And no, I didn't get the slightest tinge of upset or anger about that whatsoever. Total non-factor. That's what really, really impressed me, along with everything else. But this is something I was very subtly looking for this. I didn't want to say anything. I didn't say, hey, are you upset? I just gauged his attitude. No upset whatsoever. So there's one of two things you could look at that. One, you could take that to mean that Jesus is actually very upset about losing legacy, but has a plan to make sure it doesn't happen, therefore is unconcerned, or does not have any plan to stop it from happening, but is not bothered by it in the slightest bit. See, you could go one of two ways. Okay, so there's some Christians who think that, who believe that the reason why Jesus is peaceful and calm and no problem is because he's going to come into this world and defeat all those who would tarnish his legacy and make sure his legacy remains on this planet. That's what they believe, okay? There are others who believe, such as myself, for careful consideration of this issue, that the reason why Jesus is not the slightest bit bothered by this is not because he's going to come down and defeat those who try to tarnish the legacy and establish it. It's because he knows that it's impossible to have a legacy on the unrepentant. He was not bothered by it at all. He knows eventually they will repent. Eventually. He doesn't have to, he doesn't feel like, well, they have to follow my example for, you know, I don't have to be the only teacher there is or somebody, you know, it's not a problem to him at all. He knows it's bigger than that because we're all, actually Jesus sees us as all complete already, totally complete. That's how he views us. It's absolutely immaculately, perfectly complete. Without any need to have ever completed ourselves in the slightest bit. We are created complete. He literally views everyone that way. So he knows that is the true legacy. The true legacy is God's legacy. And that is not threatened in the slightest bit. So he's not bothered at all by the tarnishing of his legacy, the confounding of his legacy, the loss of his legacy in this world. It's not an issue with him at all. It doesn't bother him at all. And he's not going to come down with a host of angels and destroy all those who would tarnish his legacy. There's no, I didn't see any plans whatsoever for that to occur. So those are the two different beliefs that Christians have. And those are in the latter camp, which I find myself in through carefully looking at this. We're free to go. We don't have to stay in this world to defend Jesus' legacy at all. He doesn't call upon us to do that in the slightest bit. Just the opposite. Remember when he left, he said, I'm going to come back for you at the end of this age, and I'm going to prepare a dwelling place for you. I'm going to come back and take those who want to go with me. I'll take them there to dwell with me, which means those who are repentant, who are willing to go, meaning not stay here to protect his legacy. Those are the ones he will take because they understand this issue of it's impossible to establish a legacy among the unrepentant. And yet all the unrepentant are just on this path of vainglorious grandiosity. They too don't have the slightest need for you and the slightest completeness to take happen to them. And Jesus sees them as absolutely perfect and complete without anything needed to complete them. Inherently perfect and complete. This is how he already sees everyone that way. It completely overlooks the dream. The dream is absolutely unnecessary. From that standpoint, from a pragmatic standpoint, supernature, healed perception is a wise intermediate step to take. But certainly, from the absolute perspective of truth, there is not anything in this dream of trying the process of completing, a dream of completing, a dream of becoming. There's not one shred of this that will ever happen in this dream or will ever not happen in this dream that has the slightest necessity to it whatsoever. absolutely no necessity to it whatsoever. And a story. In other words, there's absolutely no need for anything to happen to complete anything. That is the truth. That is the truth. So, we just rest in the wow of this, because this is very, very heavy stuff. In a certain way, it leaves no wiggle room. Yeah, I think a lot of Christians assume that their mission in life is to fight for Jesus' legacy here. And they assume that's what Jesus wants them to do. Well, I actually met with Jesus, and I didn't ask him directly, but I certainly, from the conversation, I could tell he didn't have any plan to do that whatsoever. There's no militancy in him whatsoever. There's no fear, no threat, no upset whatsoever. And of course, I know, hey, Jesus, you're losing your legacy. I mean, look what's happening. I mean, there's absolutely no concern for that whatsoever at this level, you know. Of course, he wants everyone to repent. Of course. But he knows this will happen for each of us when we're ready to. So he doesn't need to try to push anything that way. So he knows nobody will be lost. Everyone's already perfect. How could they be lost? How could they be lost souls? That's the most ridiculous teaching there is. That people are going to be annihilated. What do you mean annihilated? What, they fail to, they keep on the path of trying to complete what they are? They were inherently created absolutely complete and perfect, and they still are exactly that. So how could anything be lost? How can God say, I'm angry at you because what? You didn't complete yourself? Or you didn't give up the notion of trying to complete yourself? Both of those are just complete, just silly little dreams. They have no effect on God's creation whatsoever. So how could God be angry in the slightest bit? It's absurd. And so our ultimate legacy is, it can't be touched. It's just waiting there for all of us. That's the real legacy. It's not that Jesus says that he has to be the legacy. The legacy is God's creation, which is completely untouched. Now, it is true that by going through the crucifixion, that Jesus honored our creativity, our adventurousness, our freedom to mock freedom and mock adventurousness and try to undo it to an absurd extent. And so certainly those who know this say, hey, then they say, hey, that's already been done. I don't need to do that. I don't need to do that. I don't need to stay here and be crucified. I don't need to satisfy the absurd demands of grandiosity. I don't need to. Jesus already satisfied those absurd demands. So in this way, people say Jesus saves, meaning he had satisfied those absurd demands already. Of course, they confound that and say, no, we want more. But we recognize that's just the obvious confounding of it. But we know it satisfied such absurd demands. And such absurd demands don't even need to be satisfied, actually. It's just beyond the call of duty. So we certainly don't have to at all. It doesn't hurt them. The grandiose claim is hurting them. It's interfering with their need to complete what they are. They're saying, see, they don't have any need to complete what they are. This is a made-up need, completely imaginary need. So again, they may revile you and hate you, and you won't have any legacy among the insane. That's fine. You will have legacy among the sane, for sure. All those who repent have a legacy among those who repent. Absolutely. And it's not even about legacy. So this is helpful for me, because I've been so upset about the loss of legacy of the saints in this world, and I've been trying my whole life to preserve the legacy, and I'm losing, fail, horrible failure. And this has just caused me the utmost grief. I said, you know, how can we let go of that legacy? It's so hard to build such a legacy. But it's really not that hard to build a legacy. All it takes is just one. All it takes is some repentant ones, and then automatically there's going to be a legacy. Just one teacher comes, there are repentant ones there, the legacy automatically blooms again in the desert. This is easy as can be. The recipe is simple. You just need one repentant spirits. That's all. As soon as there's repentant spirits, there automatically will be a legacy. Doesn't matter how you label a legacy, really. The unrepentant, of course, will claim that it does matter. So Jesus was just, he did what he wanted to do for him to totally honor it, so that he could then totally say, okay, I've done what I need to do to be in responsible for the whole, all of salvation for all spirits. So there's not a tiny trace of doubt in his mind, you see, that he's totally honored to the extent of saving everyone. Now, so we're not in that position. We don't need to do what Jesus did. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. But from his perspective, it may have seemed like, you know, the grand gesture, you know, to of grace to do that, to show his love for everyone, to all. Says, no, don't worry, I'm not judging any of you, okay? Don't worry. So because he's in charge of the whole thing, so he felt that this is like the right step, the right thing to do. To reassure forever, everyone for all, ever and always. Okay, he's in charge of the whole thing. We're not in charge of the whole thing. Okay. So all we need to do is just realize we don't need to fight to protect any legacy. Jesus already has done this. And this legacy can be spoken of anywhere, anytime. But it's up to him. It doesn't even need to be spoken of. Because what it did was it enabled Jesus then to be absolutely assured to then build this momentum for salvation and share share with all of us the truth. So it gave him the feeling like, I'm going to do this. All right. So it really is between Jesus and God, this thing. And not really such for us such a big deal, actually. I know that's shocking to some, but it's not, we don't have to. So in other words, a legacy can be bloom anywhere in all of the grandiosity when there's repentant souls. And you don't have to reference any specific teacher at all, okay? Because the momentum is already there. Jesus stands behind the entire mission of salvation. In all places and all times, under all names and labels, whatever, stands behind it all. And will continue to stand behind it, because Jesus assured himself that this mission is possible, and it's righteous and just, etc. Okay, so we already have like a big boss, so to speak, that's standing behind the whole thing. So we don't need to worry about that stuff. We just need to think the thoughts that we think with God, which is very simple. And we don't need to do worry about any specific legacy, battle for any specific legacy. We need to be part of the legacy by our own clarification and liberation from delusion, which will help out the overall mission of salvation for all, to save us from this dream of completing. That's what we need to set down. Everyone needs to set that down. In order to recognize our absolute freedom. Obviously, you cannot have a dream of completing and still recognize that you're absolute freedom that has no need for completing whatsoever. How can you recognize you don't have any such need whatsoever? None of creation has any such need to be completed. How can you at the same time believe in the necessity of this dream of completion? You cannot have both. It would be utter confusion if you did, right? Totally. The only way you could hold that is complete chaotic confusion, which you cannot adjust to at all. And so you cannot really hold on to that. You can't hold on to both. No. This is what I found out. I wanted to see if that was possible. It's not possible. Each one completely rejects the other. Completely. And so you just have this complete chaos where you can't say, well, which is right? Because each one's totally denying the other. It just feels like completely chaotic. Oh, I can't stand this. So, no, obviously, can't both be true. Truth and lies can't both be true. But in crazy, outrageously bogus accounting system of grandiosity, it claims, well, you need to honor this, you know. You need to honor this by trying to make it true. No, we don't need to honor it that way, you know. We'll honor the overall fundamental basic adventurousness and freedom that is at play here, even though it's in a very whimsical and silly play. But we'll honor it by supernature, death-free realm of a vision of completeness. Vision of completeness is how we'll honor it. Okay. This is above and beyond the call of duty too, but certainly we understand that a little bit of honoring is just fine. That's fine. Not a problem. We'll do that. But again, we will not defend this to the unrepentant. We will not defend this doctrine to the unrepentant. So obviously, if we leave this place, we won't be here defending any legacy of anything, you know. But the legacy will be alive wherever we are, you see. We won't lose it. In fact, we'll be even more aware of it. We'll be like extraordinarily aware of the legacy. And so we'll be able to bring that legacy with even greater potency some other time, some other place, where there are repentant spirits, you know, who repent, change their mind, say, hey, this, I cannot, in attempting to honor this grandiosity, the idea of holding both this dream and reality together, can't do it. The dream of necessity to complete reality, and the reality, the fact that there's absolutely no need for complete completion whatsoever, you cannot hold both those together. I tried, can't do it. So, at that point, you repent. You realize, wow, there's nothing left to do but to repent. Say, I can't do it. So this, what grandiosity is demanding of me is impossible. It's ridiculous. It's beyond absurd. It's impossible. And the insisting that I do the impossible, no, that's going too far. That's asking too much. The insane, the grandiosity will always demand that. They say, I'll never repent unless you do that. I'll never. Oh, yes, they will. Because in their desire to be happy, they will try to, you know, meet their own absurd demands. And they find out they can't. So I say, those who are making these absurd demands, let you first meet those demands before you ask me to meet them. I already know it's impossible. So I'm not going to try to do it again. So those who keep making these absurd demands, let them, absurd accounting, let them give the proof that it can be met, their demands can be met first. The burden of proof is on the ones who are making outrageously silly demands, okay? So they have to prove that they can do it. And of course I know they cannot prove it. So in the attempt to prove it, they will then realize, wow, I can't do it. And then immediately reason will come in and say, wow, I have to repent. There's no other path for me. And then, just like that, suddenly the teachings, the thoughts that we think with God, suddenly we can understand them. We say, oh yeah, that makes sense. How come I didn't ever understood that before? It's easy. This is how we feel. We'll struggle and struggle and struggle to understand teaching, and when, as soon as we repent, it becomes very clear to us. We say, hey, that's simple, that's not difficult. How come I spent my whole life thinking this is so difficult? It's not difficult, it's obvious. And then the wow hits you, and then you say, yeah, but I don't, there's something wrong. I don't know what's wrong. And this is my teaching is that I'm emphasizing, is the continuity fear is what's wrong. Failure to recognize that stalls us out on the path. Because we'll misinterpret and think, well, there must be something wrong. Maybe it isn't clear, is what we'll say. Well, maybe it isn't so clear. No, we say, no, it is crystal clear. I'm just having a continuity problem. You know, fear, continuity fear is kicking up on me. But it is very crystal clear. And certainly those who've gone this way can testify to this fact. That if they look back 10 years before, and like right now, they're way more clear than they were before. I mean, it's easy. The clarity is much easier for them. They say, yeah, I can just see this easily. It's not a problem. But they know that they used to be able to see it, but it was a big problem. Now, it's not so much a problem. What changed? Nothing changed except the less continuity fear is the only thing that changed. The truth stays exactly the same. It's like the teachings of Jesus, which are the thoughts that we all think with God. He gave those out recently, in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, the other voices also. And the words there are the same as when he gave them out as right now. But so when I first read them, I said, yeah, this is true, but I don't understand why I'm having trouble. Now, same words, same teaching, I look at it and say, it's obviously totally clear. There's no problem with that whatsoever. What changed? Did the teaching change? Teaching didn't change at all. What changed was my level of continuity fear. That's what's the only thing that's changed. It's the only variable there is in this equation. The only variable there is in this equation is our continuity fear. Truth is invariable, so that's not a variable. It's a constant. Now, some people approach it mathematically, if that's the way they're mind. Just look at it that way. The truth is a constant. And the variable is continuity fear. That's the only variable there is. How could there be any other variable? So, for all of us, including the mathematically inclined, this is a full stop in the wow. Because you know it's true. How could there be any other variable? So all our calculations, we're expecting to fill the blackboard with complex mathematical equations, and we realize, no, it's just this simple. Constant, truth is constant, divided by the variable, or variable of continuity fear equals delay. Solved by / practice. And evaporating the continuity fear. No more need for equations, you know. Just like that. So the shock is like, wow, I thought my future is going to be full of equations, and now I realize it doesn't need to be at all. It's just this simple. Wow. And then we say, well, let me add a few equations here. You know, I don't need to. I better add two just to make me feel. And then they look at the blackboard and they say, oh, this is pretty complicated, huh? No, we just put a bunch of unnecessary equations there. So that we would feel like, you know, I'm not losing my future so much. I expect my future to be like this, and then suddenly it's all changed. Well, let me make it seem like it's a little bit like I thought it might be like, yeah, like that. That's all. That's just, you know, the honoring our creativity and our continuity fear. Honoring our continuity fear, really. Which is honoring our creativity, absolutely. It's pure honoring our creativity by honoring our continuity fear. Now, the teachers, it's really interesting to me. The teachers come into this world and they don't seem to be the slightest bit concerned about their legacy. And then I always thought, well, that means they expect us to take care of that, you know? So I thought it was my responsibility to take care of the legacy, otherwise it's going to be lost. And that puts a second horrible burden on me. But I never seemed to know anything about their legacy. And the truth is that whoever is repentant will automatically be attracted to them, and whoever is not will not. And that's all that can be done. You can't do any more than that here. You can't do any more than that. So for me, this is the biggest issue of all, is you know, what is our responsibility here in terms of legacy? Are we supposed to fight to protect it or just do nothing about it? Now, Jesus says our only responsibility is our own salvation. That's it. But in, during these times, that it's extraordinarily difficult time here because it's really the collapse of legacies here is taking place. And so we're worried about those who are going on without any legacy. You know, it's This is the question. I just have to let the wow settle down on this one. You know, I can't struggle with it because I can see that there's a lot of struggle that could happen there, which means I'm not going into it with enough clarity. If you see an issue that you can tell there's a lot of struggle there, step back. Don't go into that yet. Wait until it's easy for you. When it's easy for you, you'll just breeze through it. No problem at all. So first order of business is what? Don't retreat. So the progress that you've already made, don't retreat, meaning don't jump into some struggle that's really going to pull you down. Just say, no, I'll have to let that, you know, for tomorrow, some other time, when I'm able to do it easily. Because what I've found is the attempt to protect the legacy of the past year only is going to pull us down right now, severely. And involve us in just also the unrepentant are vicious because of their unacknowledged continuity fear and their insistence that you know, continue to honor what they're trying to do, because if you don't, you're responsible for their failure and things like that. They're very insane. And so you can really get in trouble that way. Jesus said, love your enemy, turn the other cheek, resist not evil, all this stuff. Meaning, well, what's the worst evil we think in this world? Just tarnishing and destroying a legacy of truth here is got to be the worst thing possible, we think, right? And yeah, so he's saying, don't resist evil here. Wow. Because what he's talking to, the repentant. See, the unrepentant, it doesn't matter what he says, is not going to make any difference. So you got to understand, Jesus really, these teachers are really talking only to the repentant ones. They're not talking to anyone else. Jesus, you know, says, he basically, I came for my sheep, you know, that hear the call of their shepherd, hear my call. That's the one I came, those are the ones I came for. So teachers come for various ones that they know are ready to heed the call, you know. They don't come until there is there is repentant ones who can heed the call, because they know otherwise it's a complete waste of their time. You know, it's a waste, and nothing's going to happen. They'll just be severely confounded, and the whole situation will get even worse, really. So, again, we will not struggle with this issue too much right now. I can sense the potential battle up ahead, and we want to sidestep that battle. So, first order of business, don't retreat. Don't lose the ground you've already gained. You know, fortify that position very strongly, so there's no way you're going to retreat from that position. And then, once that's fortified, then assess the situation in front of you, you know. And you'll find, once you fortify the progress you've already made, the resistance ahead of you will dissolve, you know, it'll be easy. But as long as you have this wowness still going, still strong, then the defensiveness seems like they have some, you know, you feel like, oh, I'll be struggling, it's a struggle, they might defeat me or something. So first we have to do not retreat, meaning full stop in the wow. This information is extraordinarily impactful. Of our situation, the overall, you know, of our liberation, of our salvation is extraordinarily important. So of course it's wow, a very big wow. So that we have to settle into that and get used to this information first before we attempt to assess what lies in front of us, if anything. And oftentimes we think, oh, okay, I see a direct route, you know, and later on, after we get used to the wow, we'll find we come at it from a different direction, so seemingly it wasn't a straight line, it's actually this way, because the straight line was actually what we expected. It was actually a zag away from it, you know. It wasn't really the right way to go at all. So the answer may be unexpected to us, to be surprised, like, oh, you know, better than I thought, wow. So when we're in this tremendous wow, it's not a good time to assess, you know, the landscape ahead of us. It's not. We will misinterpret it. So this is where the humility comes into play. It's very important that once you make a really strong advance, have the humility to say, you know what, there's enough wow factor right now that I don't feel capable of really assessing, you know, the landscape ahead here. I'm not really sure how to proceed here. So let's just hunker down here a little bit. Get used to the wow, set up camp here, reinforce the, you know, reinforce, and then when that's taken place, we'll reassess the situation. This is the way that we need to proceed, the wise way to proceed. And of course, we're getting very short on time, because the legacy is about to be under extreme attack. So this is a super important question about what do we do. I mean, I'm going to be asking Jesus for the thoughts that we think with God, what thoughts we think with God, address this question, you know. But right now, we've made so much rapid progress that it's very important to not push things too much. What is today, 27th? Yeah. What do you have today? Today, 27, 28, 29, 33, and 5 days. 5 days till the new year. As I have said, I fully expect the next 18 months to be an unprecedented deluge against all spiritual legacy on this planet. The real legacy, you know, the ones that we know about. I'm certainly very keenly aware of the spiritual legacy on this planet. And so I'm aware of how bad it's under siege. And the plans are to collapse it entirely, and to collapse it into a new world order, new world religion, actually, which is focused on just works, which means what? Let's help complete everything. Look, these people are dragging. We need to, you know, they need to get up to speed, and they need to work towards completion. And so much of the world, the teachings of the world are already this way. That they say we're human animals, human creatures created by God. We're incomplete, but God is helping bring out our potential, and we'll gradually, you know, need to grow into our potential and all this. This is all nonsense. Okay, this is all grandiosity. And I have to say, it's absolute grandiosity, totally. And forgive yourself for that. We had this silly notion of mocking our freedom and mocking true adventurousness. Adventurousness, mocking ourselves. And trying to be greater than God by mocking what God created. By mocking ourselves, we're mocking God. You see, but Jesus told us, or someone told us, I think probably Jesus, God is not mocked. God does not mock at all. All our mocking doesn't affect God at all. So most of the teaching that I come across is dualistic. We have to, this is how we can go work towards completing ourselves. But of course, we can never really complete ourselves. But we can get better, you know, better or something. Or God will finally complete us once we do this. And this is all grandiosity, mocking God, actually. So that's really not a legacy at all. Don't need to protect that legacy, really, right? So much of the legacy of this world actually doesn't even, the idea of protecting is ridiculous because it's all nonsense. It's actually the clever accounting of grandiosity trying to justify itself. We certainly don't need to protect that, right? That is for sure. And again, Jesus sees all of us as we truly are, overlooks the stream entirely in that way as far as our identity is concerned, and realizes not the slightest bit of what happens in this dream or doesn't have this dream has any bearing on what we are. No bearing, zero. Zero, zero, zero bearing on what we are. No influence whatsoever. So in that way, overlooks the entire dream, entirely. From the standpoint of our identity. Now from the pragmatic standpoint, certainly recognizes the dream from a pragmatic standpoint of a continuity issue, but not an identity issue at all. No, overlooks, as far as identity goes, overlooks the dream entirely. And as Jesus says, he doesn't see anyone as bodies at all. Sees all of them as this beautiful, glowing, shimmering, golden light that extends endlessly. He sees himself that way. He sees us that way. Doesn't see us as bodies. So, in other words, and sees us as we were created, inherently perfect, inherently complete, absolute, pure freedom. And it sees us as joyous, adventurous, joyous, fearless, just blissful and loving and peaceful. That's how he sees all of us. I mean all spirit, all spirit. I'm not referring to these dream symbols, bodies and stuff. I don't even see that in terms of our identity. But in terms of pragmatism, of course he can see bodies and all that, I imagine. But it's not... That's not a view of our identity at all. You can say, oh, this stick figure and this stick figure and this stick figure and these symbols and symbols, these symbols, you know. It's not an issue of identity. So we can see nature, super nature, but not as an issue of our identity. Although nature, we can have nature appear to us as in inherently complete way. I mean, it's always been this way, always will be this way. No need for any change. We can use forms of nature to show us a mirage like that, and then this then reassures us of the completeness that we inherently are, and then we don't even need a mirage for it eventually. YouTube finally made a really great adjustment. They allow videos now 2 hours and 10 minutes, realizing that a lot of video cameras take in 20-minute segments. So if you have 6 20-minute segments, that's 2 hours. And the way they process it, and the way it is, maybe 20 minutes and 1 second or 2 seconds or something. So it went over the 2 minute. If you went over the 2 minute, 2 hour. I'm sorry, 2 hour. About 2 hour and 10 minutes. It went over the 2 hour limit, and so then I had to chop it up into part one, part two. But now allowing 2 hours and 10 minutes. If I go a little over 2 hours like that, or just, you know, close to 2 hours, a little over, I can put in one video. So that's really a huge, huge improvement. Took them a while to figure it out, but it's really a very welcome improvement. And certainly, we'll always be grateful to YouTube for allowing us to share this information together here. No matter what they do in the future, they may be, you know, part of the collapsing of the legacy on this planet, and Google may be part of that, et cetera, et cetera. But still, we did, you know, honor what we truly are by using YouTube and Google service, you see, for doing this. So that actually is a very positive. Something very positive that we'll carry with us, and those who may be unrepentant as yet will somehow, they'll feel, you know what, I must have done something positive at some point, you know, even I don't know what it is, I just feel like I must have done, and it'll help them in that way. Again, the next 18 months, I'm just kind of helping us wind down through this wow, because the first part of this video, generally what I do is I bring the first part of the video, I really bring it strong and build up this wow, and then we need to just kind of just not retreat, settle into it. We've made, you know, massive advance here, massive, incalculable. Don't try to calculate it. This is very important. Don't measure, don't try to calculate. Stay away from calculation, like it's some deadly plague to you. Seriously, like it's worse than Ebola. Just say, no, I'm not going to get near that. It is way worse. So thanks to, you know, YouTube for hosting these videos. Now ultimately, because as I said, this world is headed for collapse into the one basket of spiritual works as being the fullest expression of what we are, what is right for us to do here. Fullest expression of spiritual righteousness on this planet is simply good works, helping feed the poor, clothe the poor, house the poor, distribute, help clean the planet up, help animals out, all this stuff, good works. That will be a new world religion. We'll say this is the highest, and all, you know, this is the highest and true expression of religious spiritual teachings. And that's it. This is what they're going for. And most people have already accepted this for themselves, have already accepted it. To the extent that they pray to God, they say, they're praying, say, God, help me be an instrument of your compassion in doing good works. See, this is what they believe. And of course, this is still completely mocking God, isn't it? The whole grandiosity of mocking God. Now, what we are is absolutely, flawlessly, perfectly complete from the very beginning. We don't know any, the slightest bit of a dream of incompleteness at all. And right? If you have a dream of completing something, don't you have a dream of incompleteness? So this is what nature is, a dream of incompleteness. And we think that this gives us the opportunity to complete stuff, to do a bunch of completing. You know, okay, I completed this project, complete. And we think we add up all this completing, we're somehow going to add on, going to actually complete what we are. You know, this is the lunacy of this whole thing. So good works can hardly be said to be the highest, most the righteous, true teaching of what's intended by God. Hardly. You might say it's just the tiniest tip of an iceberg. Okay. As I said, there's nothing inherently wrong with charity and good works, absolutely. Help one another, love one another here. But that's the tiniest tip of the iceberg. And to say that that's it, hey, there's no iceberg below the surface, right? It's just this little tiny dip there. This is the new world religion of tolerance, they call it. And what? Tolerating what? Tolerating the absurd accounting of grandiosity is what they're tolerating. Say, be tolerant of our completely outrageously absurd accounting system that is always in complete flux. And it's just all plausibility here, plausibility there. Whoops, let's change this, whatever, you know. Totally fluid, no constant variable whatsoever, you know. See, no, we must, you know, this is, we must honor it this way. This is what we've come up with. This is what you must believe. Otherwise, you're dishonoring us, dishonoring spirit, dishonoring creativity, dishonoring freedom, dishonoring adventurousness, dishonoring you, and therefore you're separating yourself out from spirit, and you'll be separate forevermore. You know, and all these threats that their crazy accounting is churning out, which is all utter nonsense. So, just like everything else that we've seen in this world, how social norms are changed. They're actually changing super fast. As I said, this Happy Holidays thing, this has just been like the last 5 years or so. Before it was Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas, and then some people got in a huff about it, you know. And now it's all Happy Holidays, Happy Holidays, Happy Holidays. About 95% of people that I met was all Happy Holidays. Only a few people said Merry Christmas. But again, almost. It's a total cultural title change, okay? It's just tokenism now, but there's a cultural title change. It's already, in 5 years, it happened like that. Something very important, and there's cultural changes in all sorts of ways. Definition of marriage, for instance, definition. There's been a cultural, you know, global title change in that fairly rapidly, based on just what a radical step it is, you know, to redefine marriage, for instance. That's a title change. All sorts of, now the police are like the bad guys. The bad guys are the good guys and the police are the bad guys. That's a total title change, global title change there. At least in the United States, that's going that way. And actually there's so many, many, many examples of this, of stuff that you know, whatever we used to think a certain way, and now we think we're honoring righteousness by flipping it real quickly. So, prayer in school, you know, global title change against the prayer in school. You can't wear religious symbols to school. What you can say publicly, I know that most of us do engage in a massive amount of self-censorship. I know I do. I basically can't say anything I want to say in public, which is, that's a global change, extreme global change, tidal change, change in the tide, you know, rising tide lifts all ships, so, or it's also a receding tide lowers all ships, actually. So what I say is this, the tide seems to be receding in many ways in the world, lowering ships, stranding many ships, you know. It affects all ships. So we're all ships on the ocean of this absurdity, you know, this dream. And so as this tide lowers down, you know, that affects everyone. Affects everyone. And so, you know, 18 months seems like a short time, but not under these circumstances, where what's happened was we're getting used to these global tidal changes happening fast, really fast. And so for us, in this world now, they say, oh yeah, we can like make rapid, radical change very quickly now, and it's not that big of a deal to anybody anymore. at some point, you know, the administration may bring in United Nations troops to the United States to protect the citizens from the police. They claim the police become rogue, and we need to have the police being policed. And they'll bring in foreign troops onto United States soil to police the police, because the police are saying, hey, we're not the bad guys. And so there's this, you know, there's this dichotomy taking place. And, you know, things like that could happen here, actually. It's very possible that the police, well, a lot of police are going to be seen as the criminals. You know, they're trying to paint them as criminals. And then to protect us from those criminals, they'll bring in United Nations troops, you know, from other countries, right? To protect the citizens of the United States from their own police, you know. This is the absurdity that could happen here. And many, many other absurdities can happen, actually. Many. And they can happen very, very fast. This is what I call the collapse into compliance with the New World Order. The collapse into compliance. It's scheduled to take place very rapidly and very quickly. Shockingly so. Shockingly so. We could declare martial law. We need to bring in foreign troops to defend the citizens against the police, their own police, you know, and stuff like this. All sorts of possibilities abound for what could happen. And with this administration, all bets are off, you know. Guaranteed, they will take whatever steps they feel needed to collapse us into compliance, absolutely. They're totally on board with collapsing the global drive to collapse us into compliance with what? With the highest spiritual teaching there is works. And that if everybody gets on that, we will feel that we've entered a golden age. And we've left all these lower teachings behind that were sort of chipping away and preventing us from the fullness of our good works. In other words, contemplation. Oh, what a waste of time. They'll feel like regret. Like, oh, look at all the time we wasted the last 2,000 years and all these great contemplative efforts when we could have been working on good works the whole time. You know, how terrible was that? And it seemed like they're coming out like of a dark, dark age. They'll feel like the whole planet is coming out of a very dark age into the light of the new age, where we all now understand what the true high teachings of Jesus really are, which are good works. And then everybody will feel like they're being liberated into this wonderful new age, and the future landscape is just so bright. Everyone has to wear sunglasses, you know. This is, you know, we're in it right now, aren't we? This is what we're going to transition to. And throwing the baby out with the bathwater. They're worshiping the bathwater. They're worshiping the bathwater of good works. Okay? And forgetting about the baby entirely. So what we're really doing is not we're going into a glorious age of light where everybody understands what the true pinnacle of Jesus' teachings, of religious spiritual teachings is, which is good works, they think. Finally, we've reached the top of the pyramid and we realize we're ready to ascend because we're so wonderful. What we're doing is we're plunging down into an extremely dark age where we're taking the bottom of the pyramid, you know, just the very tip of the iceberg. We're ignoring everything else to better to then honor this insane accounting system telling us, honoring this dream of grandiosity, needing to complete it. Say, no, we got to complete this dream of completing what we are, completing reality. We got to complete it. If we don't complete it, reality will be incomplete. This is what we believe. If we don't complete this dream of completion, reality will be incomplete. And so everybody must honor this effort and get work together on it. It's a matter of it's a matter of survival. I mean, it's a matter of, if we don't do it, we'll be annihilated. Reality will be incomplete. God has put us on this mission to complete reality. We must do it. And so, by putting everything into good works, that's easy to then use that as to tell everyone they need to get, you know, peak super functional. Don't waste any time in contemplation. Don't have any drop in your functionality, which the wow does produce, of course. Because then the wow says, hey, we don't need this dream. Wow. We don't need it at all. So how am I going to function? How do I function? I'm not quite sure. So there's a little drop, you see, in functionality. So they want super functionality to be taught to everybody in the school system, which is why they want religion out of the schools entirely. They say, well, it offends us. No, it frightens them. Because they think that functionality is salvation. Super functionality in nature, in this dream of incompleteness, is salvation. Their salvation. It's nothing but as a ridiculous escapade into grandiosity is all it is. This whole thing about evolution versus creation, all this kind of stuff, what's going on? It really, those who say in creation, what they're saying is, hey, God can create instantly, basically, you know, and by extension, we can create instantly too. So it's just a vague sort of basic idea. Say, hey, wait a minute. You know, the evolution is not the way God creates. That's not how God does it. God does it, his will, it can be instant. Whatever he wants is, you know, this is reality. So what they're really saying is, no, I remember reality. The evolution is not part of reality. So it's very close to saying, hey, this is just, is a grandiose dream. They don't quite go that far. You know, there's still too much continuity fear for them. But they do keep saying, no, they bring this principle up. It's a matter of principle, okay? It's a matter of principle. Of course, we've fashioned all this grandiose dream to make it seem like it's all just a process. Of course, it's a fantasy of process is what it is. But what, you know, so, you know, what they're saying is it's a bigger issue than just, well, God created the world in 7 days here, and it's, the world's only 4,000 years old and all that. No, of course. But that's just, they can't get past that, but there's a bigger issue, you know, a bigger issue there. So at least that bigger issue is being raised by what they're saying. So, but they want to get rid of that too. You see, they don't want that issue. They say, you know, they say, no. This is a situation of incompleteness. That this is, you know, we have to complete this. This, our job here is to work with evolution. Work with this dynamics of process. This is all a process leading to completion. See, this is what they want to say. They don't want to hear creation at all. They say, no. It's a process leading to completion. But that's why it's a big, big battle there. And the creationists say, no, there's no process like that at all, really. So they're closer to the truth, actually, much closer, even though they're still kind of blind about it, you know, they're not fuzzy about it, they're not quite sure, you know. But they say, you know, there's a principle of creation, you know, that God does create and doesn't go through process. So they want to get rid of that, you know. Those who want to collapse this into conformity with the New World Religion, New World Order, centralized bureaucracy, where everyone will be checked and double-checked and 1,000 times over. What are your good works you're doing? We support religion. In fact, we support the highest religion possible. We're supporting the highest religion possible. We're supporting the true religion. So what they'll say is the New World Religion is the true religion, called from all religions previously, the last thousands of years. We don't need them anymore because we've been able to extract the essence of them. And the essence of them, we've realized, is good works. This is what they all agree on. So we've all been able to agree upon this. We have this global ecumenism. And we've said, hey, time for discussion's over. We're ready to launch this new age, folks. We're ready, and the mothers are ready to give birth to this new age. There's so many wonderful women in the world ready to give birth to the new age and be the mothers to a new age and raise this child. They're all here waiting to raise this new child, the new age. And so there's no more discussion, folks. We've got it, you know. We've got our marching orders. And so they're ready to march. They're ready to march into the new age. What they're really doing is they're marching into this tunnel of, you know, inky black darkness is what they're really doing. And following the bite fibers, the mothers are saying, come on, children, follow us, mothers. We're ready to give birth to this new age. We get it, you know, we get it. all this time we spent not contemplating has finally paid off. You know, we kept our mind on materialism, we kept our mind on this bodies and structure, and now all that's paid off and we're ready to give birth to this new age where we're focused on what's really important here, really relevant, which we're going to work real hard to make things better and help move, evolve things a little closer to completeness. You know, this great, great effort that's been going on for so long, billions of years, we're going to be a part of a chain, you know, a link in the chain that goes on for billions of more years, that we're going to move it closer to completeness. And they're going to drop the legacy of the last of thousands of years, just drop it, you know, like it never happened. We don't need it anymore. We extracted the essence. It's like juicing, is it? We've juiced it. The pulp, we throw the pulp away. You know, we got the juice. Don't need the pulp. So yeah, and it's good to present it in this humorous format. It really is. It really is. This is my preferable format to do it. You know, it's so over the top, isn't it? This whole situation is completely over the top, and it's funny. It's over the top. It's funny. And it's literally happening, you know? This is what's taking place here. The dream is just so absurd and over the top. You have to laugh at it. The unrepentant, you know, they really are very earnest and try very hard. They're very intense about it, you know? We gotta complete this, folks, you know, and we're the ones who are getting it done. You other guys and gals, you know, you contemplates. You're slackers. We can't have any slackers around here anymore, you know. It's no more slacking, guys. No more slacking, I'm sorry. And of course the worst guys are the men, you know, who've mostly done the contemplating. There's certainly some female contemplatives too, some very successful, famous ones, of course. But by and large, it's been men who, and so the New World Order really hates that. It doesn't trust men because they think men have some sort of recessive gene that, you know, causes them to think they can commune with God, you know, and contemplate and stuff. And we can't trust them with leadership positions in this new age. No way, no way, no how. Which is why you're seeing this incredible influx of women into crucial positions of administrative, bureaucratic leadership, if not into corporations, but certainly a lot of that too, but in a very crucial administrative, bureaucratic positions, so many women are coming to there because the men are not trusted in the new age to have leadership positions because of, they think they have, again, this recessive gene, something about men that want to start getting lazy and start contemplating, slackers. Can't have any slackers in the new age. And we certainly can't have any women appreciating contemplation, saying, you know what, I'd like to do that too. Oh, no. Hey, wait a minute, we got a better job for you. Here's a bureaucratic job. You can, like, tell everybody what to do. Oh, okay. Now, that's interesting too. And we'll give you all this stuff. Just don't appreciate contemplation. Those men will do that. Bad men. Don't appreciate them. Don't support them. Don't say anything good about them, because that's slacking. And that's not what Jesus really wants. What Jesus wants is we'll all be working really hard in our functionality here and get this thing completed. Come on, we've got to all pull together here. Get it all. Move it towards completion. Come on, we got to move it. Got to get our human potential, you know, more evolved. Let's evolve our human potential here. This is what Jesus wants. This is what religion wants. They're all in agreement with this. Nobody disagrees with this. Nobody. Anyone disagrees with this is just a slacker. You know, just trying to rationalize their laziness. This is the New World Order that we are entering into. How unprivileged we are. It's just Pied Piper's playing, marching into this dark, dark tunnel. In the side of a mountain, just going on underground in this dark, dark tunnel is all it is. They're saying, We're going to go underground here. We're going to go hide from the truth here. We can hide from the truth in this dark, dark tunnel. I am spirit. I am free. There's absolutely nothing I need to complete me. There's absolutely nothing I need to complete me. I am light. I am free. There's absolutely nothing I need to complete me. Very cold here last night, 31 degrees. First time it's dipped down like that. What, December 27th? Yeah, it's about time for that. No rain. The rain stopped in California. And as far as we can tell, 10 days ahead is nothing. That's scary for us here. We've gotten Decembers before we got rain, and then it stopped raining no more. So, wow, don't want that. Don't want that. So we need like about, we need like a couple of months of monsoons here. Otherwise, the Golden State is going to be pretty much kaput in a lot of ways. There'll be a big industry of bottled water shipping in from everywhere. Whole, you know, tanker ships of water will probably be coming in, and water will become super expensive. Only people can afford to live here, people can afford to buy water. In a lot of ways, I mean, it's already, the only people who can afford to live here or to move here are super rich people, or laborers, essentially, who work for peanuts, working for the super rich people for peanuts. Again, always we give time for the wow. See, a soup that is the ultimate in importance is we're in a no hurry to finish the video because that's an insult, that's a mockery, damning with faint praise what we've done. Because if we have not brought up a tremendous amount of wow in this video, then we've been wasting our time entirely, right? And if we have brought it up, that means we need time to just let it settle in, to let us get settled into it. To do a short little video is damning truth with faint praise, to say the least. I don't like those. It's what? There's no wow to the information. Information's really heavy and tells the truth, but there's no wow to it? Opposed to, oh, okay, get it. That's all conceptual. Okay, I get it, conception, got it. That's just feeding conceptuality. There's a lot of people who think they have the truth conceptually. A lot of people who say they're enlightened, which is what they just have a concept of enlightenment. And they believe they're enlightened because they have they say, oh, I got the concept of enlightenment. Yeah, that's it. I got it. And so, here we give time, we hang out. It's very important to just hang out for a while. Super important. Because I know this information is incredibly intense as far as the wow goes. Having been through the path for so long of this wow, having been practicing wowism for so long, knowing how much progress I've made, for me, this still brings up tremendous wow. You see, so I know that for virtually everybody, it's extremely intense, no question. There may be some who've gone further than I have, less gone further, and so it doesn't bring up so much wow. But if that's the case, they certainly know that for virtually everybody else, it does. So there's no grounds for them to criticize this whatsoever, because for the vast 99.99% of people, listening, it will bring up a tremendous intensity. And so it will bring up a tremendous wow. So we do need to give it time. Obviously, we're not doing this video for the ones who don't need it. Obviously. So those who are more advanced don't need this video. We're not doing it for those who are more advanced and don't need this video. So there's no grounds for them to comment at all or criticize at all. Just, they should just continue with what they need to, where they need to find the wow. Just ask God, you know, God, what thoughts do I need to think with you that still bring up a wow? God will answer. Absolutely, God will answer. God is within all. We're all inherently perfect. Perfect freedom, perfectly complete. There's nobody lacking God within them at all. So. So we've already brought up the intensity now. We're just hanging out with it. That's all. It's just a matter of giving it time, giving it time, and not trying to make a further advance, you know. Don't put yourself under pressure to make too much of a further advance. Talking about, you know, what's coming in this world for me, it's a humorous break. It's a very humorous way to release some steam, you know, to look at the frantic designs of grandiosity, you know, and have a good chuckle at it. Jesus said the whole problem, we forgot to laugh at this ridiculousness. So we're laughing right now. We're looking at the designs of grandiosity and having a good chuckle about it. It's really quite absurd. Knowing that it's all totally unnecessary. You see, we don't get mad at it. We just laugh, we get mad, we chuckle, laughing out of love, you know, out of our freedom. We don't get hooked into it. Nice try, you know, it's funny. It's like a joke. People are like very unsophisticated from, you know, they like try to run some scheme or scam on you, and you've seen it all before, and it's so blatantly obvious, you have to just laugh because you're not under any threat to fall into that trap or anything. But for them, wow, that's funny. Because they think they're like being really clever, you know, and running this to get you, to trick you, and to you it's just funny. It's just funny because I've seen that one a million times. Yeah. So let's not get angry together. Let's laugh about it. You don't really expect me to fall into that trap, do you? That's funny. Isn't, you were joking, right? Oh yeah, okay, you're joking. But the unrepentant are not joking. They don't think it's funny. Well, you laughing at it? We're working on moving towards completion, and you're talking, you're slacking, you think that's funny? You know, they don't think it's funny. We do. Calling us slackers, you know. The ones who have done the work that's needed to be done, which is work on our continuity fear, we're slackers. How can we be slackers when we recognize that what we're being called to do is impossible? That's not slacking. Yeah. It's ridiculous to call it slacking. No, we are accepting our absolute freedom, which is the opposite of slacking. That's the very opposite. The ones who are trying to complete themselves are the ones who are slacking off, actually. Slacking away from their functioning in reality. certainly our functionality and reality, the fullness of it, is beyond anything we can even imagine in this, you know, from the standpoint context of this dream. So this dream is the slacking. It's 100% being total slackers. And the total slackers are blaming the ones who are not slacking and think that they're slackers. Complete reversal, you know, complete reversal. And of course, those who are going, accepting that they are inherently complete, the slackers claim, you're the ones being grandiose. You say that you're one with God. How grandiose can you be? We don't claim that. We say we're far away from that. We have a long, you know. So they claim that we're totally grandiose. And yet, here they are mocking reality, mocking freedom, mocking God, mocking the completeness that is God, trying to be greater than God. That's what's grandiose. They're the ones who are grandiose. The notion that they can complete something that God created complete, mean they can add on that what God was in, it didn't, is insufficient, like pure freedom is somehow less than, there can be more than pure freedom. That's the ones who are, those are the, that's grandiosity right there. So they tend to completely try to reverse things on us, you know. They're the slackers. They're the ones who are in grandiosity still. They're the ones that need to repent, not us. We're not grandiose at all. We're accepting us as God created us, as complete and perfect. That's not grandiose. We're the ones who are willing to get back to functioning the way we're supposed to in expressing our absolute freedom and its incredible creativity. That's not slacking. We're not slackers. We're getting back. We're dropping the slackerness. We're dropping the laziness. Getting, you know, saying goodbye to it. Don't need it. Doing the tough work of getting through the continuity fear. That's the tough work. So, again, they're mischaracterizations of us. Can we defend that to them? No, absolutely not. We don't need to. Let them. They will always mischaracterize truth. Always. As long as grandiosity isn't, you know, this dream is being supported by spirit, mischaracterization will be what is part of it. It's inherently part of it, mischaracterization. So again, I'm not here to defend my teachings to the unrepentant at all. They can say whatever they want to say. I'm saying they can completely lie, deceive, make up stuff, twist, whatever. I'm not going to defend it at all. Whatever they want to say is perfectly okay with me. But to those who are repentant, I will keep making it clear, you know, this is what I'm saying. This is, you know, this is true. This is this. Keep on emphasizing it like that. Not defending it, but re-emphasizing it is a way of defending it. You could say it's just not defending in arguments or anything, but just saying, just restate, keep restating it, keep restating it, keep restating it. Because they basically say, did you say this? Is this what I heard you say? I say, yeah, this is what I heard. This is what you heard. Wow. They say, wow. I thought that you'd said that, but I wasn't sure. You know, I sort of think maybe you said something different because, you know, no, you did say that. Huh. I go back and read what Jesus is saying over and over and over, and I keep saying, is he really saying that? Is this what he really saying? And yeah. And every time you hear it, you become a little more aware of this. He really is saying this. He wasn't saying something else. He really is saying that we're inherently perfectly complete. He really is saying that. There's absolutely nothing we need to do to complete what we are. Absolutely nothing we need to do. He really is saying that. So the more you hear this, you realize, wow, this really is. I was hearing right. I am hearing right. Huh. His grandiosity is hearing wrong. So reinforcement, repentant need reinforcement, reassurance, and they're willing to do that. They're willing to do that, not in an argumentative, disputational mood at all. In a mood of repentance, saying thank you for reinforcing this. I needed to hear it again. I needed to hear it again. And again, truth is so simple. It's not complicated. You don't need some structure of complexity, academic. You don't need an academic structure for this at all. No. There's absolutely no aspect in all of creation that has even the tiniest need for even the tiniest bit of completion to happen to them. Okay, not even the tiniest not even one tiny bit of all creation needs even the tiniest, tiniest bit of any completion to happen to them whatsoever. This is the entirety of the teaching right there. In a nutshell, that's all you need to hear. That's all you need to hear. So you don't need an academic structure for this whatsoever. You need a contemplative structure. Okay, we don't need an academic structure at all. We need a contemplative structure, which allows our functionality to kind of dip because of the continuity fear. It's that simple. You see the contemplatives, you know, maybe sitting, just walking quietly in the garden or sitting, and it's like, wow, you know, they're like in this wow state. Like, did I just hear the God that's saying this to me? Wow. This just my expectations, you know, just sort of like poke up in smoke. I mean, wow. And so they, you know, it takes, you know, quite some time for most of us to keep adjusting our expectations, realizing it's this simple. It really is this simple. Wow. I thought I would be dealing with trying to complete all this universe for forever, and I realize I'm free right now. You know, this is what happened to my expectations, you see? What the continuity fear, how difficult it is? What about my legacy? I don't need to be involved with nature anymore. And my future, no. So it's like, wow. And your functionality just feels, I don't know what, I just want to sit here. So this is the contemplative context that we need, that those who repent and need this type of context. Yeah, the chill is here. I mean, once that thunderstorm came through a couple days ago and brought the change in temperature, wow, it all changed. The whole ambience flipped into winter just like within minutes. It was amazing how quick that happened. Never seen anything like that. Never experienced anything like that. We still had the feel of autumn all up until, what was it, the Wednesday, the day before Christmas. It was the day 24th. It was still felt like balmy autumn. It was wonderful. A thunderstorm suddenly just appeared just out of nowhere almost. Start pouring out of nowhere, and suddenly the temperature dropped 15 degrees. And once it came through, passed through, it's been very chilly, clear and chilly ever since. And an instant winter happened, instant winter from that. Instant winter came instantly to us, almost instantly. It's a very interesting precursor to the next 18 months, actually. Maybe you can say it got started on the 24th of December, this 18-month March. So through the 24th of December, that's 12 months, then January, February, March, April, May, June. Through June 24th is 18 months. So I would say we need to be confirmed in our clarity by June 24th of 2016. Okay? June 24th of 2016. This is a very good, to put that on your mental calendar. June 24th to 16, that's 18 months. I'd like to say be confirmed in your clarity before July of 2016. Before July of 2016 is the wisest path. So 24th of June 2016, let us be confirmed in our clarity here. And certainly we can do that as we get the rate that we're going right now. Now that we understand the tools, so we're, you know, first order of business, don't retreat. Honor the continuity. The wow. Honor the wow. Full stop in the wow. We can make very rapid progress. And of course, you have to give it time. This is the whole trick about it, is because the world now is all into super functionality, meaning don't be a slacker. So the pressure is on to don't spend any time at it. This is the only problem that we have, really. If we're willing to give it some time, like a two-hour block, like I'm doing now, there are about two-hour blocks, for sure you will make so much progress, you looking back, you just say, wow. That's all you can say. Even now, the progress I'm making is just wow. Just like stunning. Remember, progress is stunning. It's easy to stay in failure. That's not difficult. It's making progress that's stunning. Anybody can stay in failure like this, the failure of setting down this grandiose dream. But it's setting it down, the success in setting it down. That's very stunning. Like, wow, I didn't realize I could do this. That's really amazing. It is amazing. It is amazing. I mean, I'm continuously amazed. It's like, hey, I'm like, this is what Jesus told us to do, and I'm doing it. You know, it's amazing. I'm succeeding. You know, what he told us to do, I'm succeeding. That's amazing. Oh, yeah, it just really is amazing. And the secret has just been continual work at it, giving it time enough for this continuity fear to evaporate, just giving it enough time and effort and focus. You know, that's been the secret to it, which is why I say contemplative context is so helpful and important. You don't have to be locked up in some monastery or whatever, no. I mean, you can give it time right where you are. This today is like Saturday morning, going into Saturday afternoon. So there's nothing going on here. There never is anything going on here. It's like a monastery because nothing ever happens here. There's no social life here whatsoever. No friends visiting, no visitors, nothing. So I can just hang out here for 2 hours straight like this. Nobody interfering. See, in monastic life, you don't have constant calls and visits from friends and stuff. No, it's scheduled. So if you want to visit someone who's in a monastery, you have to schedule that ahead of time. They have a certain time for visiting. So it's that way, when they're in this, wow, and their functionality is dipped down. Wow, I don't even need this dream of nature at all. Totally unnecessary. Wow. They don't. That friend doesn't show up from high school or something. Hey, buddy, I just came to see you. Now let's have some tea and coffee and let's talk. And let me tell you about my life. It completely throws them into, you know, jitteriness. So, whoa, I'm not sure how. I haven't reconstructed, you know, my future. It doesn't happen. Of course, they cannot have that happening like that. It's ruinous. It's very, throws a monkey wrench into it all. So, that's why there are visiting times that are scheduled. And occasionally, those in contemplatives of the culture meet with people, the public in general. There are times where they get together and they all pray, have a service together or something like that, absolutely. But the stuff is, it's set aside. There are certain times that are set aside for that. The rest of the time, they're not to be interrupted like that. Now, this is what we all need, is not constant interruptions. What we have now with the society, tweet, email, you know, boom, 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 boom. Notification, smartphone, interruption. Very bad. Very ruinous. That's another reason I don't have a smartphone. I don't want anybody interrupting this. I don't want to be notified. I don't have any notification system. Except that, you know, a phone call, which I can put my phone on silent mode if I want to, or vibrate mode. But if you get a call, you just deal with it simply, and okay, that's it, right? And then go right back. Don't let it bother you. But certainly, the way that people have their smartphones set up, ding, 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 ding. Oh, you know, that's why. I remember one of the companies here, is Yahoo or Google, one of the big companies. They hired a yoga instructor. Some of the yoga instructors said, okay, leave all your smartphones. Don't bring them in. And this caused them to be fired. Yeah, so you can't do that. That's to get too serious. No, that's ridiculous. That's not part of our culture. No. So people are getting notified, you know, on their smartphones during yoga and stuff. And the teacher said, well, no. That's not, you know, going to help out. And fired. Terminated. So this is certainly an extreme problem in the world, to say the least. I mean, where was I yesterday? I was in church, and there's little children, like the girl's like maybe 5 or 6 years old. She had a smartphone, and she's charging it in church, plugged it in some outlet, and she keeps jumping up and checking her phone every like 5 minutes. She'd get up and run to her phone and check her phone, and she'd run back to her seat. You know, this is what's happening in Christmas Mass. 5-year-old, young, 6, I don't know, very, very, just a child. So the children are getting these smartphones now and to play games on, right? To play all these games, and they're the babysitter. The smartphone's the babysitter. But they're becoming addicted to these devices now, totally addicted at a young age, and thinking that this is how they interact with the world. And so they've got to stay in touch with everything that's happening, being news story, weather story, some story, something happens. They have all these preferences and notification. I need to know about this. I need to know this. I need to know what this celebrity is doing. I need to know a story on this celebrity. See, I don't have anything set up like that. I have zero notification system set up. So if I want to find out, I can check. I want to check on the San Francisco Giants. I'll go to, you know, their website and check. Any news, you know? Don't have any notifications set up. Not even for email. None. Super important. Because it's a slippery slope. Once you start getting hooked into notifications, there's no end to it. You know, Amber Alert, some alert. They'll put more and more alerts on your gadgets, alerting you about this. You need to be alerted. The bureaucracy will start saying, okay, the whole globe needs to be alerted about certain things, okay? And you'll have a whole notification system, and they'll demand that you be part of that notification system. Otherwise, they say you're likely to be a slacker. And since we're entering the golden age of Aquarius here, that we're all going to be able to finally, you know, develop our human potential properly. That slacking is totally unacceptable, because we'll ruin our opportunity. So now is our great opportunity, and it's such an important opportunity that we're just going to have to have a very harsh attitude towards slackers. We're sorry, but that's just the way it is, because it's totally justified, because we know what righteousness, true righteousness is now, and now that we know, and everybody knows, we're able to see what slacking is all about. And you contemplatives, it's obviously you are undermining something that is super important to God, and therefore we must deal harshly with it. We're justified in dealing harshly with it. And they will rationalize. They've already rationalized dealing harshly with what they define as slackers. And so you're supposed to be hooked up and notified. Oh, you weren't notified? What happened? I'm starting to get that too. What is it? You didn't know about that? You weren't notified about that? What? How is that possible? I think I got that recently. It's like, they feel like, whoa, that's really weird. There's something wrong. I mean, something's wrong with our notifications. So how come you didn't get it, you know, the notification? Everybody has notification. This is what I'm getting. What do you mean? Everybody has notification now. What do you mean you weren't notified? I said, I don't need to be notified. And of course you do. What are you talking about? You don't need to be notified. So you're put on the defensive. Very much so put on the defensive. I'd say, have you been notified that this new age is a total scam? Have you been notified about that? Have you been notified this whole notification system designed to interrupt contemplation, which is your real path to salvation? Have you been notified about that? Really? You haven't? Well, how is that possible? You haven't been notified about that. That's weird. It's really weird you haven't been notified about that. It must be slacking. It must be really slacking then. You know, to a turn around, I don't think they'll like that, will they? That won't play very well. That won't play in Peoria anymore, folks. That is for sure. So it's like, wow, I see, yeah, huh. So the thing is, the righteousness of this New World Order claims they're not dealing with people harshly. They're just dealing with them rationally. This is not harsh. This is just what they deserve. They need to be re-educated. That's not harsh. How can re-education be harsh? We're just helping them get up to speed, which is beneficial for them. This is the, communist China, same thing. This is the model. And we're not punishing anyone. They get real angry. What do you mean, political prisoner here? Well, what about all the people in these prison camps? Well, we don't have any prison camps either. What are you talking about? No. These are re-education camps. This is where those who are challenged, who are progressively challenged, this is where we give them loving therapy and treatment to help re-educate them and get them up to speed. So it's a very loving, helpful thing we're doing. We don't need prisoners or prison camps. That's all propaganda rhetoric against us. It's totally crazy. What are you talking about? It's exactly how it is, isn't it? It's exactly what we're going into. The models have already been tried out like this. And we have to laugh at the absurdity of their position, of course. But to them, it's their accounting system, their bizarre accounting system is deemed that this is the right approach here. We got the right approach here. And don't bother trying to figure out their accounting system. I've already looked at the whole thing. It's like, oh my gosh, it never ends in its permutations, its plausibilities. It's like there's a continuous twisting going on. Always, whatever twisting, the goddess is always twisting. That's just funny, just twisting. Whatever needs to be twisting, you twist this way, twist that way, twist. Always twisting. It's no set accounting plan at all, just always twisting. Whatever suits the moment, whatever they need to come up with, the accounting back fills it with a twist, Okay, this is what it is. Oh, it needs to be this way, let me twist it that way then. Never ending twisting like that. And then again, how dare you call me a slacker? I'm not defending. I said, I'm not going to defend anything I said to you or whatever. I'm not going to defend any teaching I have to you. My teaching is only for the repentant, you see. So you can say anything you want to about me. Don't need to. Did Jesus defend himself? It's very important when he was arrested. Before Pilate, defend yourself, Pilate said, Jesus didn't say anything. He didn't come to defend his teachings to the unrepentant. Only the repentant he spoke to. He didn't say a word. He said, you say these things. I'm not saying anything. I'm not defending myself here. I'm not defending my own. No, not at all. So again, these videos are for the repentant ones who... this is like music. They can hear the music. To them, it's like music. And to the unrepentant ones, it's like chaotic, horrible noise. You say, wait a minute. What are you talking about? This is music. Where's the music? I don't hear it. What note? What are you talking about? Well, this thing. What? Yeah, that? But this one over here, this doesn't sound like music. How does this fit together? It's endless, right? To them, it's just noise. Just noise. Some commotions happening. So, that's June 24th, let's say June 24th. By the afternoon of June 24th, let us be confirmed in our clarity. June 24th, 2016, let us be confirmed in our clarity. Let us work at it very diligently. Let us not be slackers. And let us not worry about our legacy or what the slackers of grandiosity what they believe or think and what they scream about or anything like that is, again, they're not reachable at this point until they repent. So they'll just confound. Whatever we say, they'll just confound. It's a waste of time. So just keep working, keep working, keep working. Try to give blocks of time. Try not to be interrupted in those blocks of time. Try to limit all these notifications that you're getting, you know. You can give a couple hours every day and then deal with other stuff the rest of the time, you know. And I have to go deal with some stuff now, so that's fine. Got this taping in. So very great. Thanks for joining in here. And this has been a lot of fun and a lot of good humor here. Absolutely. I enjoyed it very much. Okay. Very great. That's it.